Welcome to Musicians Talk. I have invited three trumpet players. Three trumpet players that I know for a long time, that I admire very much, all three of you. You're creative players. Jarmo Hoogendijk, who I won a competition at the Meerva Jazz Festival in 1982. And the year after Jarmo won the competition, was it 83?
That was a couple of years later.
A couple of years
later. Mid-80s.
It was mid-80s.
Yeah.
And I went to see the finals and I thought, like, wow, what a trumpet player. And then later we played together in the big band of Michiel Braun.
Yeah, that was, we did in the early 90s.
That's how we learned, how we know each other. Jimmy Czerneski, I came to Amsterdam to study at the university. And there was a band playing in the street at the Leidseplein called Available Jelly. And Jimmy was the trumpet player in it. And of course, Huub van Riel sniffed it out and invited them to the Bimhuis. And I had seen them a couple of times at the Leidseplein already. And then I saw them at the Bimhuis. And Jimmy played a fantastic solo on Salt Peanuts, I seem to remember. The next thing is about... I've just started playing the trumpet myself, so I was like, wow. And about 2 years later, I think the phone rang if I wanted to join Available Jelly, because Jimmy started to play the drums in a theater company called Pigeon Drops. I think that's about right, isn't it?
Yeah, what year was that then?
I mean, this was 83 or something, like I seem to remember.
It could have been, yeah. But I was with Pigeon Drop already, but
you couldn't make the Available Jelly tour, and then I was asked to do
all those guys something. Were busy too, but they weren't. They stayed here, and I began to tour like 10.5 months a year, and I just couldn't commit to when they wanted to play, they could play.
So I was asked to come and play in Available Jelly. It was my favorite band at the time. And it is about the same time, early 80s, I went to the conservatorium to get in, and I did my audition, and they let me in, so I don't know why, but anyway. But the guy after me who auditioned was Angelo, and the window was still open. It was somewhere in July or June or something. It was nice weather, the window was open, and I heard Angelo play his own theme to Half Nelson or Joy Spring or something very complicated at this audition for the conservatorium, and I thought, like, whoa, fantastic trumpet player. And we played in the big band of Michiel Braun later as well. So that's how we sort of like how I know you, and I've invited you to this table just to have a chat about trumpets, about music, about anything we like to talk about, politics, you name it, it can all be.
Sure.
But first I want to know, like, Jimmy, you were born in California, or?
No, born in Terrace Bay, Ontario. It's a town that was founded in 1948 for the Kimberly-Clark pulp and paper company, but my father and mother wanted to emigrate to California, where the streets were paved with gold, but I think just to follow other families who went, because my mother was in love with one of the husbands already there, so it became complicated. But that I moved to Arcata, California.
So you're Canadian.
I'm Canadian. I'm still Canadian.
Canadian born. All right.
But I grew up in Arcata, California, which is 6 miles from Eureka. Vatcher's from Eureka, and me and Mike and Greg and all those are from Arcata.
Michael and Arcata Greg Moore and Michael Vatcher, they're from there as well.
Yeah, and yeah. And Barry Block also moved up to live with me when I was 18 years old.
Yeah. And how did you start playing the trumpet? Is that?
I wanted to play the tenor saxophone, really. But
the tenor saxophone. Come on.
There was a presentation from the school, and I saw these players. I thought, wow, amazing. This alto player. I said, wow, they're so cool. Later, when I joined the band and I played a bit, I realized he couldn't really play, but I was so impressed. And I wanted to play a tenor saxophone, to play rock and roll stuff and whatever. My parents went to the Maxon's Music in Eureka, and they got me a clarinet. It was tenor saxophone was too expensive. I refused to touch it, even look at it, although I did secretly look at it once. And then my mother showed up at my elementary school with a trumpet, and she said, "Learn to play this or I'll wrap it around your neck." And that was it. the band director.
So you were forced to play the trumpet.
Well, the band director he played violin, piano, and guitar, and he kept telling me I should play trombone or baritone because he thought it wasn't working on trumpet. But I always sort of had this, chop difficulties or something, or the embouchure was not really working that easily for me or something. It's a lifelong curse. But anyway, that was it. That's why I started. And
how's that for you, Jarmo? I mean, I'm from a brass band. I started in a brass band playing the tuba, and then when I was a student at 19, I bought a trumpet because to travel with a tuba was impossible. So
yeah.
I'm a late starter. But do you come from the brass band or?
Yeah. I was in a brass band since I was 12, but I was already playing the trumpet for 2 years then.
I see.
In the local music school in Den Helder.
Den Helder.
Yeah. This is in the north of
the
northwest of this country, Netherlands,
But soon I was in a brass band too, and in an amateur chamber orchestra, and in an amateur brass quintet. It was a great time.
Great.
Fantastic. I mean, North Holland.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with North Holland when it comes to
learning. No,
it's like Limburg.
Yeah.
Where you have this culture of brass bands and whatever is going on. Yeah.
And you, Angelo, you
exactly the same thing.
Same story.
I was going to do a music school for like theory lessons, and at some point we got to choose an instrument.
Uh-huh.
And hang on, I chose banjo. Really, and but my neighbor, my neighbor friend was exactly the same age, and we joined that music school together. And his grandfather was a member of the local brass band, and they needed flugelhorns in the brass band. So this guy told me he's a respected dentist right now in the town where I come from, in Oss. But anyway, this brass band were in desperate need of flugelhorn players, so he talked me into playing flugelhorn in a brass band. So we did, and it was so much fun. It was a really good brass band, and like Jarmo and Den Helder, we had there was a lot of competitions.
Yeah. A study by some trumpet player who interviewed in America in the 1960s or 1970s.
Oh, ships.
He made like a survey.
I'm joking.
That he sent to about 60 like famous trumpet players, classical players and jazz players. Lee Morgan filled it in. No, not Lee Morgan. Dizzy Gillespie. I seem to remember Kenny Dorham, Woody Shaw. All fantastic trumpet players, but also what's this guy, Gerald Schwartz, like a famous classical players. They all filled it all in, and one of the questions was like, how many hours do you practice, and what do you practice, and all kinds of so a whole questionnaire about 10 questions or something like that. And then in the end, he started to sit down and try and work it out, what it all meant. And then one of the conclusions that he drew from this whole survey was that jazz trumpet players, they practice much more than classical players. classical players, they train, like, you know, being precise and everything. And his conclusion was like, improvisers, creative musicians or jazz players, whatever you want to call them, they also have to practice their music. They have to be very much more busy with their music. Therefore, they spend much more time on their instruments. I think that made sense, but I never thought about it that way, really. I always thought that classical players, they were busy with practicing all day, I thought, but no.
Well, if you talk about really the greatest jazz trumpet players, I know many of them did 8, 9, 10 hours per day.
Yeah.
Certainly when they were young.
Elder, Albert, these guys.
You shared a house with Woody Shaw? Or did Woody Shaw stay with you?
No, he stayed in my apartment for a while.
Yeah.
And at that time, he wasn't practicing anymore. But in his younger years, it was 8, 9, 10 hours. Then to the gig, and gigs in those days, in the 60s, 70s, there were like at least three sets of a full hour, if not four. And then to the jam session. And the next day, eight, nine hours of practicing again.
Man. Wow.
Yeah. Well, then you become a monster player, if you can do that. Who can practice that long? You know who can just pick up the horn and play without warming up?
Wim Bot.
Wim also. And also Ak van Rooyen.
Oh, yeah.
He just picks the thing up. Yeah. Boom. Wow. It immediately sounds perfect.
That's true.
I mean, some of us, they need minutes before they even get a sound out of the horn.
Ak is how old is he now?
90.
He's 90. He just won the Boy Edgar Prize.
Yeah.
And he just still picks up the horn and plays
it. That's right. Last year I did this workshop thing together with him in the south of Holland, in Venray or Venlo, whatever. And he sat in front of the audience and he started talking and he unpacks his horn. Like the valves were all just stuck. He hadn't touched it in weeks. So there were all kind of all people, you know, like rushed up to him, like making sure that the valves were working. So the valves were working again, and he starts playing.
Just like that.
Like this sky opens up.
Yeah.
Like he had this rhythm section of students, and you know, he started playing Stella or whatever, and man, you don't know what you hear. It's like.
Wow.
Absolutely.
Wim Bot is a high note specialist who worked for the WDR big band or something like that.
Yeah.
And I remember doing a demonstration with him in Den Haag. We had to have hundreds of trumpets or something. Some Gilius van Bergeijk had, and I was walking with Wim Bot, and we were trying to play as loud as we could. this sort of like low D flat on the E flat on the trumpet, and he said, "Well, yours sounds better than mine." that's what we talked about. All the we had to walk for miles. I don't know. trying to play as loud as possible. Stupid.
Whenever Wim is not working, or even when he is teaching, the horn is in the trunk of his car.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
And so some of his students tell me that a couple of times per year he says, "Okay, let me get the horn out of the car." It doesn't work today. It doesn't work. Yeah. Shit. And then
always complaining.
Always complaining. Always complaining. And then in the evening, like, whee.
He plays everything like up the octave.
Yeah.
Man.
I was with Wim in Nueva Manteca. We were in Puerto Rico. So we went several days earlier just to have a little bit of holiday. And Wim was only on the beach. We were also on the beach, but every day we asked the hotel, the portier, "Can we practice with the horn section?" "Yeah, sure, here's the key." So we practiced a couple of hours, and Wim, just on the beach, comes the gig.
Because he side streets everything too, so
and he never misses a note. He hears all those notes of them, which I find.
Well, what kind of work made that embouchure that worked so well?
Well, he had a classical training.
Yeah.
In Rotterdam. Yeah, yeah. He had a classical training. So. Yeah. So we know how it works. But apparently, I mean, his physics are just made for that instrument. I don't know why. I had the same thing. We played in Maiden Voyage Big Band, and we had this gig in you know, late August, like the first one after the summer break. And he came in and literally he came from his break and he had to oil his valves and he just played a lead trumpet. He just played the gig, man. It was like,
yeah.
Yeah. I wonder if, because it seems like it's about study, of course, and practice, but there's an aerodynamic factor to it that you can't be set up. I mean,
that's true.
You can't just pick up the horn cold, as never played before, and have a great embouchure, I guess. But I mean, I don't know how.
He has something working for him, obviously. But again, I mean, he knows how it works. But
wow.
Opens up the trumpet. Okay.
So he's still playing. I don't.
I mean, F3, and you're like, beep.
And it's head on. Yeah.
He's still working with a big band in Germany.
Yeah. WDR. I bumped into him. In
I have to look him up.
Airport or something like deal. Couple.
I saw him right after the lockdown here, like the third week of March. I saw him at Hufvudstadsen, and he got a bit scared because. This is a guy that never practices, and of course all the work was cancelled. So that's a bit scary for him. Because I know Jelle Schouten also, he stopped playing last year. He was also a tremendous, really, and also big sound, but he, you know, he never practiced. So he was in good shape when he had a lot of work to do. He was in good shape, and when work was low for a while, it all.
I see.
It all stopped working. So and then this, of course, the same with Wim. These guys are, you know, they're not sit down and play tunes like we might do. You know, just have fun and. Or maybe put up an Abersold and have some fun or whatever, you know, or I mean, if you don't do that, if you don't feel for doing that, if you don't practice.
Yeah.
And you have to keep working.
Yeah. Yeah.
The most outrageous story I ever heard is from Huug den Ouden.
Oh yeah, that's, yeah.
Huug den Ouden, he played with Toon Hermans.
Yeah, he's an engineer.
And in big bands, Vara Dance Orkest, things like that. And then,
which is like
there was. And then they had a reunion of what was it, the Ramblers or Vara Dance Orkest. So they had the part. So like they hadn't seen
radio one orchestras.
Another. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So they get to play, and after the first set or during the second set, whatever it was, his lip starts bleeding, whatever. And one guy says, "Haven't you played in a while?" He said, "Yeah, 3-4 years."
But that's, I mean, our colleague Toby Dalius, the tenor saxophone player, he has a lot for a while. He had a ulcer on his lip that hardly ever healed.
A callus?
It didn't give it enough time for it to heal, and then it burst open for years on end. It was like you stand and play, coming out.
Whoa!
And then, at a certain point, it was all fine.
Luckily, my lips are fine, except for I was like, I don't know, 17. I played Carnival down south.
Carnival is in the south of the country, yes.
All the in out, and I split my upper lip, and of course the next day you have to do it again, like start in the morning.
Yeah, of course.
And then there's like this little blister, and then so the next morning you start again, just opening up this blister.
Whoa, just
you have another beer just to ease off the pain a bit, and that went on like for 3-4 days. So this thing got bigger and bigger and bigger, and then on Wednesday morning I sat at the doctor's, and he says, like, "What's that?" I said, "Well, that's I had a blister like this on my upper lip.
Whoa,
that was terrible. So we had to cut it, and that's nice. And that's when I stopped.
That sounds like Louis Armstrong, huh? Yeah. He was cut my, it himself.
Yeah, yeah. That's my last carnival I ever played, and after that, I never
fine lips.
Yeah, huh. But
Whoa.
Yeah,
and Wim Wolter also tells me that sometimes he gets tired after a very heavy gig, and he says that because he has got such thin lips.
Yeah, he has very thin lips. Yeah.
He says if there's any swelling, the next morning it's gone.
Yeah, it's just
gone. So it next morning it's okay again. It's flexible again.
These lips are like they're like inside all the
time. There are no lips that get damaged.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
I got my ass kicked once in Hawaii, in Honolulu. I was waiting for a bus, and his car was driving around looking for some little white kid to beat up. And I was 22 or something like that. But I turned around, I saw this really big guy, Hawaiian guy, coming towards me, and he just started beating the shit out of me. And 2 days later, I flew back to San Francisco and then drove to Fort Smith, Arkansas, and I had to play trumpet and drums and valve trombone at the same time, like in this shell group. I couldn't make a sound out of the trumpet. It was like... Pretty quickly, I just forced it. And that might have been a big mistake, but I had to go through with it. We had a lot of gigs. We worked for weeks and weeks in the hotels and stuff. And
it heals. Yeah, I had a knee in my lip once.
Oops.
And the lip was over my teeth. With my tongue, I couldn't feel my teeth anymore. It's like, what? And we had a tour in America a couple of weeks later, and I thought, oh my God, that's it. I couldn't feel my teeth. And then I felt, and my lip just got stuck on my teeth. They were still there, so I pulled it out. I went to the hospital, and then I said, "Oh, I cut my lip. I'm a trumpet player." "Oh, well, lips heal very quickly," they said. I said, "No, but I'm a trumpet player. Can you?" And so they stitched it up. And that was it.
They stitched your lip up.
And 2 weeks later, I could play again.
Wow.
But my teeth were not out.
They stitched up lip. So the inner side of your upper lip.
The upper
they stitched up your upper lip.
It was like this. I only could feel my lips. I thought, "Oh, what? My teeth are gone." No.
I'm glad I didn't see
you. So we all have our injuries.
Terrible.
Whoa. Well, you had a bit of an injury as well. Yeah. Well,
Huge. Yeah. I was able to play for one more year, a little less than one more year, and it was hurting every day. And then I thought, okay, this is it. And then a neurologist said, "Well, you just need to rest. That's it, so rest for 3 months." So that's what I did. But it was still the same thing. He said, "Okay, well, rest another 3 months." So after 9 months, I just figured out that it was a torn upper lip muscle. This muscle here, an kringspier, here was torn. So
is that skirt. Like the nerve is cut or?
This spear is gone doorgescheurd.
The muscle has been cut through.
Yeah.
My Lord.
Where are the muscles around you? There's muscles here?
Somewhere.
Here there's this and there's here, loads this of side, them. Was, it was doing nothing. It was dead. There zat a scheur in. And die is gerepareerd. En dat maakte iets uit, maar toen, doordat ik hier ben opengesneden, was dit ineens keihard geworden. En dat is het nog.
Right,
dat is het nog. Dus als ik wel eens...
Kan je het in het Engels?
Oh ja, ja, ja. Whenever I put a horn on my face for a couple of minutes, this looks ugly.
Uh-huh.
It looks terrible. It swells up and it stays swollen.
Oh, man.
And then it starts leaking air and whatever, so... I just gave up.
But you're a trumpet teacher. How do you teach? I'm so curious after that.
Well, it's rather simple. I went to talk to a lot of colleagues, mm-hmm. brass teachers, and I met some trombone teachers, Ilya Reinhout, George Wiegel, and they said, yeah, we always hear you play the whole day. So we thought, how the hell can you do that? We never bring an instrument when we teach. So George Wiegel said, man, just come a couple of times and I'll show you some things. And then he says, well, when you know how to do it, you don't have to play anything. I figured out very quickly that the best thing I can do improvising is just singing things for them.
Yeah. Yes, yes, yes.
Including yes. The jazz phrasing
yeah.
and articulation. And at first I was scared. I had never sung yeah. at all. But my students said, well, we will join you. And
yeah.
I'm always singing now in the lessons. So as a kind of ear training.
Yes.
When yeah. we go through certain chords or whatever, or an extension on a chord or an alteration, let's sing it first and see if we can hear it
right.
before we play it.
Yeah.
And it works fine. It's yeah, it's yeah. fun. So after a day of teaching, I'm not tired here.
Yeah. No.
Well, maybe my voice is half gone, but that's all.
Yeah. How do you feel about, I mean, you're on top of the world as a trumpet player, and then you couldn't play anymore. Must have been...
It was difficult and it was a relief. It was a mixture of both.
Wow.
It was a mixture of both.
So what was the relief to start with then?
Because I knew that from that moment on, I had the possibility to start living a normal, regular life without the excessive drinking.
Mm-hmm.
Going to bed on time, eating on time, getting out of bed on time, looking after myself.
Yeah.
And not all this madness
that I've
been doing for 30 years. I mean,
you did the fast lane, so to say.
Yeah. Yeah. So in that respect, it just had to happen.
I mean,
it wasn't easy.
No.
It was not that easy at all. But I just knew that this had to happen. Yeah. I just couldn't predict when it was going to happen. But when it happened, I thought, okay.
All right.
This is the time.
Yeah, because all the people that I invite to this table, they're all musicians. They all have this, I don't know a better word for it than vocation, sort of like a roeping.
Yeah.
As in, you know, you're called by some whatever. Everybody is in the music. All of us are, and then to have to been able to be part of that and having been able to help create it and develop it, and all of a sudden you can't anymore.
It wasn't easy, but I still feel part of it.
Of course, yeah, that's nice.
After a day of teaching, my head is so full of music that I have to either meditate or take a shower in order to switch all that music off.
I've been
improvising for a whole day
when
I teach, but then singing instead of torturing myself with the trumpets. And when I go to concerts or listen to music, I still feel part of it.
It's
not disappeared.
No. Well, that's great, because I was wondering if it was a taboo subject or something, but you talk about it so freely, like you're really okay with it and everything. And I was wondered, you know, because I haven't talked to you for 20 years or something, longer.
At least. Yeah.
All right. Geez.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's wow.
Yeah. Yeah. You get used to it. I mean, you're married to someone 30 years. I hate love marriage. The marriage goes over. It's a bit painful. You find someone else, and after a while, you feel okay again.
Or if you find yourself, not someone else.
Or you find yourself finally.
That's
wonderfully said. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Well, I should thank you very much for joining me, Jarmo.
Thank you for inviting us.
Angelo. Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks for.
I'm honored to be at the same table as you guys.